Hi guys, you're from Sharp 11 Transcriptions here. Today I will be talking harmony. This will be a harmony tutorial on this amazing tune by Paul Simon, Still Crazy After All These Years. This live version at Central Park struck me as an amazing version of this classic tune. And when you dive into it, you get amazed by how complex actually the harmony is and so inventive. Songwriting by Paul Simon here. And besides really interesting harmony with modulations including and very cool chord progressions, you have Richard T who plays some amazing voicings, and the way he accompanies it is really cool. So I also transcribed a few of his voicings because I thought it was really interesting. Other very cool factors about this version in 1991 live at Central Park is that it's with Steve Gadd on drums, which is always amazing groove, and Michael Brecker with a truly amazing solo on saxophone, which I transcribed earlier and is already on the channel. So before we start, I want to mention that you can find the melody, like kind of a lead sheet, which I took actually from lead sheet in the real book, but this is also the reason I started transcribing the chords myself, because this was not so good. I didn't agree with a lot of the chords, so it's also in the key of B flat, and that's a real book key, of course, but the real key is in G major that they play it. So the melody is mainly a guideline to see how the chords fit to the melody. Let's start with listening to the intro, because there is already a lot of things happening right there. Okay. You might already ask yourself, why is there an A major 7 as a first chord when we are in G major? That's really not within the key. And a first tip I can give you is, if you don't really know where some chords might belong to or how they fit in, you might want to consider going backwards. So we see here, this is already a home point. So we are home here in G, the first degree of our key. And then when we go backwards, this is the fifth degree to one, which is very common harmony here. Here you see B minor over D, that looks more difficult than it is. It's because of voice leading. We get to that later. C major 7 is the fourth degree of G. A minor 7, second degree. And E minor is a sixth degree. Nothing really difficult about that here. But then we see here the B plus and a B augmented chord here is really not within the key. How did he get to this? Well, the melody, of course, and the B is preparing for this E minor. It's a relative 5 to E minor. And this one also shares the fifth degree with E major 7. So this is the pivot chord where the modulation happens. E major 7 here, and then A major 7. So A major 7 is the fourth degree of E, because we have a D sharp. So it's clearly E major and not A major. So that's about the chords. Here it looks also a bit more difficult than it actually is, but it's all about voice leading here. Also very interesting is the melody, because it's a really cool sequence, like you can see here, with the half tone going up, and then we have the same rhythm and sequence here, like the first bar, and then also half tone going up, half tone going up. But the chords don't follow in the same way, so it's put in a different context here. And what you can see here is I wrote the voicing, the typical gospel voicing by Richard T, which is playing the first degree, keeping that first degree and going in an inversion to the fourth degree and back to the one. So that looks like this. Very gospel-y. One last thing to mention about this intro is that it's taken from the B part or the bridge part of this tune. At least this first few bars we will see again in the bridge. So let's listen to it and then we go on with the melody. But listen to it and see how the harmony works here.
I met my old lover on the street last night.
Okay, and then here the melody starts with a first degree. Then there is the first degree we make dominant, because that works. That's the relative five of the fourth degree. Also one of the cliché tricks here. And also with the third in bass, so we have one more leading tone towards the C. It makes it a little bit stronger than if you would just keep G7 here. Then we go to F7, which is a flat 7 dominant chord going to 1. That's a very common progression. It's a bit more advanced theory with modal interchange. I won't dive into that here. We don't have time for that. But if you want some examples, you might know Song for My Father is a very well-known tune using this, and it works very well. It's also really cliche here. Flat 7 going to 1. And then if we continue, there is the first place where I didn't agree with the real book. And here it says F sharp minor 7. In the real book it says F sharp diminished. But here, if you use a bit of common sense also, you can see it's a 2-5-1 to E minor. And in almost every 2-5-1, the second grade is half dim. So that also fits, of course, as a 7th degree in G major. Try it for yourself. F sharp minor 7 flat 5, so half dim works much better, and that's also what is being played here. Then we have a very nice line by Richard T here, which I wrote in. And please forgive my piano skills, I'm not a pianist. As you might know, I'm a saxophone player, but that's what is happening here and a bit isolated, so it's easier to hear. Here we have then, we go to E minor 7, 6th degree, and then we have a constant structure here happening. So the E minor 7 is going chromatically down towards the D minor 7, which is a 2-5-1 towards the 4th degree in G, and that is C. Richard T plays also a very nice line there, but let's first listen to the whole thing starting from here, bar 13.
She seems so glad to see me, I just smiled. And we talked about some old times, and we drank all shows of beers.
And this is really cool. I like that a lot. His line here on D minor 7 going into the 6th. He plays here. It interferes a bit and goes even over the melody here. But that sounds like this. So then we have a 4th degree here with the sharp 4 dim, an ascending dim chord going to the first degree but with a 5 in the bass. So it's a kind of 5 feeling. We are somehow at home, but we still have tension with the D, the 5th degree. Then it's the actual 5th degree, but still not resolving to or 1. It's here going up with another dim chord, the sharp 5 dim chord going to E minor. And for people who don't know why a dim chord works, here a D sharp dim, it's the upper structure of a B7 flat 9. So a B7 flat 9 would be the relative 5 of E minor here. And this is the upper structure actually. And then we have a little cool trick Richard T uses to prepare this actual A7 here. He goes up chromatically, also with a constant structure. So let's listen from bar 21 and listen to that line.
Still crazy after all these years. Still crazy after all these years.
Boom! That's really nice here. Here he used another technique to delay this chord with the use of a 4 minor. That's the most corny chord I know there is, and I like to call it the Meg Ryan chord. Because if you know the actress Meg Ryan and you see the movie she plays in, then mostly when it's dramatic and when she's crying, then these kind of progressions happen. I'll show you an example in the key of C, where it's C to F minor, the 4 minor going back to 1. Final teardrop with a sharp 11, of course. So that's that sound. And then we have a little line by Richard T again, which is really cool. Here it goes to the 5 and boom, here in bar 30 we are finally home from the first verse is done here. So let's listen to that. And before we go on, first let's go to the next page. And here you see a rhythmic thing which I did, and probably a lot of people won't agree, because actually you just can't keep the meter still in 3-4. But it's because of the melody that I think there is a little illusion happening here. Let's listen to it.
I'm not the kind of man.
There is a break for the melody here for Paul Simon, and he sings it's a kind of, and then man is the strongest word. For me it has a very sense of one. Listen again to it.
I'm not the kind of man to socialize.
And what also helps is that for this sense of timing that I wrote down here is that Steve Gadd's role starts also here on what you could call the one of the 4-4. So it really feels like an upbeat of 4 counts, like in 4-4 towards here. For me at least, I can imagine that people feel it otherwise, but let's listen to it, and then we go back to what we already know with the flat 7 and 1, what we saw before.
I'm not the kind of man to socialize.
Flat 7 to the 1.
I seem to lean on old familiar ways. And I ain't no.
And here, listen to this nice substitution chord by Richard T here, where we had before the constant structure, E minor 7, E flat minor 7 to D minor 7. He plays here on the D minor already the G7, so he anticipates it by one bar, and then he plays a sub 5 to it, the 5 of G7, which would be D7, but it's with a tritone substitution, A flat 7 going to G here. So listen to that again. Very nice thing. Bass player just plays what he always would play, and he perfectly lays this substitution. They perfectly work without having to correspond with the bass player here. So listen to it again, and then we go on, and you will see so a few things we talked about before.
And I ain't no fool for love songs that whisper in my ears. Still crazy after all these years.
Little lick by the piano.
Still crazy after all these years.
One, but dominant 7 or 9. And that was a really nice modulation to the next part. There we have our A major 7, like in the first bar of the tune, like in the intro. But what actually happened here? How did they modulate that so nice here? You see, the G is our one chord. But here they make it dominant 7 or dominant 9 in this case. And they use it as the pivot chord, so it was first the first degree. They make it dominant, so this is now the flat 7 dominant to this A major 7. But the cool thing about this is it gives a flat 7 1 feeling, but this is not a 1 or A major 7, like I said before in the intro. The E major here is the 1, and this is the 4. So it gives a flat 7 1 progression, but the 1 is also a 4 for this 1 here, the E major 7. Really cool modulation, super illusionist Paul Simon here. And also listen to the sound of the modulation. It also supports very well the lyrics 4 in the morning. Listen to it one more time.
Whoa. 4 in the morning.
Yes.
Tapped out, yawning, longing my life away.
Okay, and here is another, you cannot really call it a complete modulation. It's again continuing the sequence, the pa ba ba da ba da ba da ba, and then the sequence one tone lower with a 2-5-1 to F sharp major 7 here. So that's again another key here. Really cool with the little fill from the keys here. I wrote down
longing my life away.
Now we are back in key.
I'll never worry. Why should I?
And again this D sharp E, but supported with different chords again in a different context. And also here you could think it's not really in key of G, a B chord. There are a few explanations possible here why it works, but it's actually the jailhouse rock thing happening here. You want to play the C, but you introduce it half tone lower, so it's like jailhouse rock. Also kind of constant structure here. Then we are back in G, and then we make the first degree dominant, like you will hear, and then we go back to 4, and then there's something strange happening. Listen to that. One dominant to 4.
I know it's all gonna finish.
And this one is really strange. Here's the real book set. It is a B chord again. But I think if you see what Paul Simon, always look at the melody if you're confused. What Paul Simon sings sounds really in tune, in context, and he sings still within G. So a B chord with a D sharp, I don't think that is the chord here. But the bass player does play a B here. But so it's really a vague part of the song. I would say I also hear a clear E here by the keys, so I think they keep on playing the C chord. Only the bass player changes to B, and then they are back to C here. Listen to it for yourself, but it sounds not so out of key like it goes here to a B chord.
I know it's all gonna finish.
Again.
Here. I know it's all gonna finish.
Okay, and here is another modulation happening. We go here to the A minor, and Paul Simon sings this little thing, which is clearly an A minor, and that's still the second degree of G. But then suddenly for the saxophone solo, they are in A major. So they make from A minor here, the pivot chord, they make A minor, A major here. This is a trick used by a few composers, like Johann Sebastian Bach did it with his Picardian thirds. That's in the end of the tunes, I know. But also in some standards you find it, like There Will Never Be Another You. There is, I think, in bar 15 or something, F minor chord, and then that becomes a F7, so a major seventh chord. But here it's our complete new key, and that works perfectly fine. For the Michael Brecker solo, you might as well check the complete solo for that. Here it's only chords. So let's skip the Brecker solo. I'm sorry, it's with pain in my heart, but let's skip it and go to the next singing part. Now I sit by my... Well, a little bit before maybe. Then you can see the transition, because we go again a modulation here. We go from A back to G with this pivot chord, the fourth degree of A, with the third here in bass, because it's an extra leading tone to the G here. The fourth degree of A becomes the fifth degree of G here. Listen to that. Yes, now I sit by my window and I watch the cars. Flat 7 here. 1. I fear I'll do some damage one fine day. Yes, and believe it or not, another modulation. We go again back to A, the key of the saxophone solo here. In a clever way, he uses the fifth degree with the third in the bass. It's a kind of 5 because it has the F sharp. That's a 5-1 inner progression to the B7 here. And then the B7 in its turn is the 5 to the E, and E7 is the actual 5 of our new key, or our old key, depends on how you look to it. Here, A major. It lifts the tune again, and let's now listen to it to the end, because then this progression we know from before, it's with all the ingredients we talked about so far. So let's listen to that. Really cool modulation. Some damage one fine day. But I would not be convicted by jewelry of my peers. Still crazy after all these years. I'm still crazy. Still crazy. Still crazy. Yes, and then we end with the McRyan progression here. 1-4 minor to 1. And this was the complete journey of this amazing tune. The sheet, by the way, will be available for certain patrons. So if you want to see more of our stuff and more extra sheets and all kinds of exercises and play-alongs, and really check our Patreon page for that. And if you're already patron, then really look out for this and you can go through it yourself. Thanks for bearing with me. Leave your thoughts here below and see you next time.